Hi, my name is Brad, and I'm the pastor at Community Fellowship. Thank you so much for tuning in to this online gathering. What you're going to see today is people worshiping God with great music and listening to teaching from the Bible that will help them live their lives. And we're excited about the fact that you're joining with us in that. If you have any questions, please ask them. If you have statements to make, make comments. And if you think this could help people around you, share this video so that others may join us. Thank you so much for being a part of this. I'll come back and see you again in the middle and the end of the video.
Steady and unchanging, your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Shines through, I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me. make me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing.
Good to have you with us today, you guys. I'm thankful that you're here. It is spring break, which means for school children and teachers alike, this is a good week, right?
Not college students.
Nope. They do not get the childish things of spring break anymore. You got that 2 weeks ago, didn't you?
Yeah.
So you already had it.
Yeah, right.
And you're griping for another one already?
Yeah.
College students. That's what that is. Love you. Just playing. So good to have you guys with us today. It is a wonderful day to worship the Lord. It's a wonderful day to think about change and about new things and new beginnings and new life as we move from the season of no leaves on trees and cold weather and snow and ice, and we move into the season of new flowers being bloomed and warmth and sunshine and even rain that brings life. As we move forward in that, we can think about new beginnings and beautiful things. Would you pray with me, and then we'll jump right into worshiping the Lord through the next song. Jesus, we trust you. We love you. And we recognize you as creator of heaven and earth. We also recognize you as redeemer of heaven and earth. And today we worship you as our own redeemer, our own savior, our own Lord. Amen.
Sinful.
Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin and left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Stain, he washed it white as snow. Dear Lord, thank you for washing us white as snow. Lord, let our attitudes and our hearts and our worship be acceptable to you today, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Welcome to community, you guys. Thank you so much for being here. It's a good day. We've talked about some good things already today, and lots of wonderful things happening in the first gathering and conversations in between the two, and so I'm glad that you're here today. Our theme for this series come to worship has been Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28. So we're going to read that together, if you just read this with me. Hebrews 12:28 says, "Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus, let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe." So what this reminds us of is because of the fact that God is so together, and because of the fact that God is so unshakable, and because of the fact that God's kingdom is so trustworthy and honorable and worthy of glory, because of those things about God, then we are to respond to him with a worship that is considered acceptable. We've been talking about that for the last few weeks. I told you in the beginning that for many, I think it's a kind of a foreign idea that there would be worship that God might deem unacceptable. Okay, that's, and at the same time, for us, it's not hard for us to imagine at all the difference between when someone is sharing their love and joy and concern or love for us versus when we know those are just words and they don't mean it, right? Like, we can recognize that in our own interpersonal conversations and relationships. Why wouldn't we expect God to be able to do the same? And so we are, as a people, seeking ways to make sure that our worship is that which God expects from us, wants from us, desires from us. And often we're finding it's not style, it's not genre of music, it's not dress code that's nearly as important as it is heart, attitude, and motivation, where these things are coming from that deem things acceptable. So we've dealt with very important, very specific things over the last 3 weeks. And today we're going to deal with the topic of confession. Now, when I use the word confession with a lot of Christians, especially Protestant Christians like us, they'll automatically draw some sort of line between the way Roman Catholics view the word confession and the way other Christians might do so. And although that is an important distinction, that is not really what we're dealing with today. As I said the word confession, you might have had visuals of a small booth with someone who sits there and talks through a window that's somewhat shadowed or in somewhat covered so that the person on the other side is not looking you in the eye, even though they may know who you are, and you're saying, "Forgive me, Father, for I've done these things," and they're telling you certain ways to respond or what to do. That is a Roman Catholic understanding of confession. That is not what I'm going to be talking about today, although my intention is not to lay shame on or in some way be negative toward that particular way of thinking. I do want to remind you that we as Christians who are Protestant Christians, we believe in a doctrine called the priesthood of the believer, which ultimately means that I don't have to go to God through a clergy member. I don't have to go to God through another person. So in other words, you, for the sake of seeking out a relationship with God, connecting to God, knowing God, being forgiven of your sin, being directed in your future, you don't have to walk through a line that leads to God through the credentialing of your pastor or some other leader. You have a direct line, direct connection to the Lord, and that is specifically defined by the reality that the Holy Spirit doesn't just rest in your clergy, the Holy Spirit lives in you. So the presence of God is in you as a believer, and we're going to deal specifically with what does God want from us when it comes to confession, and what ultimately matters when it comes to confession. And so I ask this question to you today: what is your commitment to confession, your devotion to the ways of the light? And I'll describe what that means after we read this text. 1 John 1, 5 through 10 talks about living in the light. Here's what John says to us: "This is the message we have heard from him," from Christ, "and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth." We're going to go back to that in a minute. What is practice the truth, okay? "But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us
our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. We're going to jump back up to verse 5 at the beginning of that text. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while walking in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. That's what he's saying. Let's leave that right there for just a moment. Do you know what I mean when I talk about light and darkness here? See, some people think that light is just doing the right thing and darkness is doing the wrong thing. And that's not really what the context is. Living in the light is living honestly. Living in the light is living without things being hidden or shadowed or masked or filtered. Living in the light is about being authentic and being genuine in who you are. It does not mean you will not make mistakes, and it does not mean you will not sin, but it also means that you will not try to hide or ignore or shadow or cover up that which is real. Living in darkness means that while living, you try to paint the picture you want people to see, paint the picture God that you want God to see. In some way, try to filter, shadow, overarch everything you can so that you're in control of the perceived reality versus reality being considered reality. See the difference? Do you know the difference between truth-telling and speaking with candor? This is an important language difference in English. Truth-telling means that you simply say the true answer to whatever question is asked of you, whereas speaking with candor is telling everything you know. The best way I can illustrate this is Stephanie and I recently traded cars. We went to a used car lot. We traded her vehicle and got her another vehicle from the used car lot. And in the process of doing that, if you've ever done this before, I kind of prepare, you know, like I'm ready. I know my stuff. I know what I want. I know what I think it's worth. I know the thing that I already own. I know what I think it's worth. I know what I expect in trade, and you go in. So let's just, for the sake of today, make up a fact. It's not real. Just pretend that it is. You're ready to go trade cars, and you know the fuel mileage. You know what engine it has. You know how many miles are on it. You know the last time you bought tires. You know how old the windshield wipers. You also know that there is a possum that lives in the trunk of your car. Okay? Again, not a reality, just something for us to consider. When you pull on the sales lot, okay, if you are a truth teller, you're going to wait for the person to ask you questions. They're going to say, what model is it? You're going to say, it's a 2008. Okay, well, what make is it? What's a, you know, it was a Jeep Wrangler. So we say, okay, that's that. What kind of fuel mileage does it get? Well, you're going to say, well, those, you know, it's not the best thing in the world. They're going to get about 14 or 15. Let me show you the sticker that was originally in the window. It will tell you what the fuel mileage is. Okay, that's great. Well, how old are the tires? Well, we bought the tires this past September. Here's the receipt from when we bought them. Okay, so I'm answering all those questions, and I'm doing so honestly, right? In the back of my mind, I'm thinking, if he wants to know about the possum, he needs to ask me, are there any animals that live in the trunk? If he doesn't ask me that question, I don't have to tell him, right? It's his job to ask me that question. That's what truth-telling is in our society. Now, speaking with candor is when you go, okay, let me tell you, these are all the things you need to know about the problems that are there. This is how much oil it burns. This is how often I have to rotate the tires. And oh, by the way, there is Omar, the possum that lives in the trunk, okay, in the back. That's truth-telling. That is, for many of us, the difference between light and dark. You see, there's no problem with you going to trade vehicles and having that way of thinking, but if that describes your prayer life, you have an issue. If your prayer life is, I'm only going to tell the things God needs, I'm only going to tell God what God needs to know. Well, first of all, you're assuming that God only knows what you tell him, which is a really bad assumption, okay? Overwhelmingly bad assumption. But secondly, I've been around folks who thought this way about prayer. They thought, you know, I mean, like last week, God brought up a sermon about lying, and the truth is I lie, so I guess God's asking me, do you lie? And I'm going to have to say, yes, I do lie, and I'm going to try to deal with that. But you know what? That other sin, greed, like I hadn't heard a sermon on that in months, so we don't have to talk to God about that. I don't have to deal with him about that. I want to keep that hidden and in the back room and where nobody is going to deal with it. In fact, I'd like to get to where I don't even notice it or I don't even remember it. That's what living in darkness is about. Living in darkness is where not only are you trying to convince God that you're not having a problem in a certain area, in a bigger way, you're trying to convince yourself that you're not having a problem in a bigger area, and you sure as well want to make sure and convince your friends and your family members and those around you that you don't have a problem in a particular area. See, my concern is that the way living in darkness works in our Protestant world is that we think this: I can tell God about my sin and he'll forgive me, then I can make sure nobody else knows about it because it's easier to live if they don't know about my struggles, about my problems, about my issues. In fact, it's easier to live knowing that I've told God about them. I don't have to talk to anybody else about them so that people will think I'm pretty well together. So I want to talk to you about that today, because that's living in darkness, not living in light. And the scripture is pretty direct and maybe even goes so far as to being harsh in the response. Not harsh as in it's wrong harsh, but harsh as in that's real. Like, that's really genuine. He says, if we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. Okay, that's a harsh comment. The next verse, let's go on to verse 7 and again. So he's talking about having fellowship with him. But if we walk in light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. Now that's an interesting factoid there. We're talking not just about my relationship with God, but now we're dealing with my and your relationship with one another. So here's what this is saying. So if I live a genuine life where I'm genuinely honest with God about what I'm facing, honest with God about my failures, my struggles, what I'm dealing with, and I'm also living honestly among people so that I'm not trying to filter my faith or in some way look different than I am, but I'm being honest, especially those who are very close to me, around me, see those things. I'm being honest with them. What it's saying is that if I live that way, and then if you live that way, so you're living genuinely and honestly with God so that you're not trying to hide or falsify or cover up or overshadow the struggles in your life, what that's saying is not only am I going to be connected to God in a greater way and God's going to be connected to me in a greater way, but I'm going to be connected to you in a greater way. So now all of a sudden, things like loneliness start to disappear as I fellowship with God and I fellowship with you through living in the light versus living in the darkness. Here's what's crazy. When we take our own interpersonal relationships into our own hands and we decide that we can manufacture an us that you will like better than the real one, we actually do harm to the relationship and make it worse. But when we choose to be who we really are and live honestly before God and genuinely and authentically toward him, and then we honestly, genuinely, authentically live who we are in front of you, even though that might mean sharing struggles and being honest about sin, what ends up happening is that something about our fellowship is strengthened. Am I making sense? We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. And then in the last couple of verses here, it says, in verse 9 and 10, it says, if we confess our sins to God, okay, if we confess our sins to God, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So the first real thought that I hope you would take home with you today is that we confess our sins to God for forgiveness. We confess our sins to God for forgiveness. This will be on your next slide. We confess our sins to God for forgiveness. And ultimately, that affects what we think about being forgiven. Because you see, if I feel like I have to in some way convince you that I'm not sinful or broken or problematic in some way, in order for me to experience real forgiveness, then I'm missing this, because no human being can ultimately forgive my sin. The only one who can forgive my sin is the one who died for my sin. And the only way he's able to forgive it is that he took the effects of it on himself. So forgiveness, by the way, is kind of a small word for what's really happening here. He's saying when we confess our sins to God, God substitutes his pain for ours. God substitutes our guilt for his righteousness. And in the long run, we are forgiven. The reason we tell God about our sin is to experience forgiveness. Now, forgiveness is a gigantic topic. It's a huge topic in our world, in our relationships, in the way we relate to one another. But for just a moment, if you could, I'd like to talk to you about what it means to be forgiven by God. Because this changes so much about the perspective that we have when it comes to dealing with our own sin. Some people deal with sin in a broken down, kind of overcome, defeated kind of way, so that the thought of confessing sin to God is similar to maybe confessing to your boss who hates you already that you broke his truck or his car or something. Like, you're now having to go tell somebody who's already mad at you something that's going to make them more mad at you. Okay? Like, a lot of folks think of confessing their sin to God like that. So they approach God like this. I did it again. Right? As if confessing sin to God is saying, don't hurt me. Or, I'm sorry I failed you. Or something like that. But here's what's crazy. What's amazing about this is that we're told from Scripture over and over and over that when we confess our sins to God, He forgives us. But not just because, okay, fine, whatever, you're forgiven. It's not that, okay? It's this literally is the closing of the cycle that He set in motion with His own Son being sent to the cross to die for our sins. This is the response He's looking for. It's the response he wants for us. So in my brokenness and my sin, in your brokenness and your sin, in the worst parts of the worst parts of your life, God sends His Son Jesus to die as a strategic move to provide the sinless lamb, the sinless sacrifice, so that grace is imparted, is given to people all over the planet. And when that grace touches you and I, we respond with faith, and that faith leads to repentance and confession. And all of a sudden, what you and I need to understand is not that God's going, you did it again, you doofus, like, you goofball, what is wrong with you? You're such a dummy. Fine, I'll forgive you because I have to, because I'm God. But gosh, stop it. Like, that's not God's response. God's response is, this is exactly what I was seeking from you. This is exactly where I was headed. This is exactly what I want from you. And it's why the Scripture tells us that we can approach the throne of God boldly. Now, we're not bold because we're sinful and proud of it. Don't misunderstand me. We're bold because Jesus' redemption is sufficient and we know it. We're bold because we know that Jesus made the first move and we're simply responding to what He's already done. We're bold because we know that forgiving me was His idea. Not something that I have to conjure up the right prayer so that He has mercy on me, but forgiveness came from Him. Repentance is His idea, not mine. So I can go to the Lord confessing my sin, knowing confidently that He is fully ready and prepared to bring forgiveness into my life. Now, this happens in a couple of ways. For those of us who in the room who might not yet be a follower of Christ, it begins first at what we call conversion, or the beginning of your relationship with Christ, where for the first time in life, you sense the grace of God being offered to you and you respond with faith. You trust Him, you love Him, you submit to Him, you honor Him, and you ask Him to forgive your sins. That so beginning or continuing what God has already done to begin things in you, and now you are a new creation. You are given the presence of the Holy Spirit. Your sin is wiped away, past, present, and future. But then the Scripture tells us that at that point we have repented. We have moved into a new part of life. We have, for whatever like local language you want to use, we've been saved, right? We've been changed. We've been changed. Our life is never going to be the same. But then for out, now the Holy Spirit is in us. Now our heart has been remade. Now our future has been set. And we still are going to fail. We're still going to mess up. We're still going to have struggles. So we're still going to confess sin to God. But at this point, get this, is really important. At this point, I'm not so much confessing so that he will forgive me. You see, I believe he's already forgiven me. But I'm confessing so that first of all, I'm thanking him for forgiving me. I'm confessing so that I'm agreeing with him, telling him what's real. And I'm confessing because this is one way that you practice living in the light. That's what he said to do earlier, right? That we are to practice living in the light. Let's talk about this a bit. Practicing living in the light is something that we all have to do. And I'll give an example. Practicing is something like everybody wants to play lead guitar like Eddie Van Halen, but not everybody wants to spend hours and hours and months and years learning how to play guitar like Eddie Van Halen, right? I'm sorry if you weren't raised in the 80s. Whoever's cool in the 90s. I don't know why, you know, whatever that is, okay? Like everybody wants to be able to catch a football, you know, like this, or everybody wants to be able to cook that particular thing, or everybody wants to be able to do that amazing floral arrangement, or everybody wants to be able to do this fantastic workout thing. But getting from where you are to there is going to take practice. It's going to take lots of steps, right? So I don't know if you guys have seen this. This is an ongoing joke in our families that this is my new sermon illustration cup that I'm supposed to put money in every time I use one of my children's stories as an illustration. What they don't know is I've decided to make that investment in Bitcoin. So some of you get the joke. So our youngest son is taking bass guitar lessons from Keith, who played bass this morning, who's like the most awesome bass guitar player. He's not here anymore, so I'm bragging on him. He's really amazing. So Jax has taken bass from him, and here's what we learned. That first lesson happened, and Keith told Jax, and he said, you know what? Your thumb and your index finger and your middle finger are very strong. Like they're having no trouble doing what they need to do, but your ring finger and your pinky, they're not very strong. They need more strength. You need to do something to try and strengthen up your ring finger and your pinky. What are you going to do? How are you going to do that? And so we're thinking things like we're going to get him racquet balls and he can squeeze those, or those old time 1980s triangle based things that guys used to pinch and like make him just use his pinky and his ring finger. Like, how are we going to do that? So I'm starting to be intrigued. We're driving home from practice and I'm like, how is it that your thumb and your pointer finger and your middle finger are really strong and the other two are not? Like, the other two are just hanging out for, like, they're they're weak and the others are strong. And I realized that, wait a second. Do you guys know what I'm doing here? You guys know exactly what I'm doing, don't you? So, like, after chores are done and dinner is eaten and the room is clean and all those kinds of things, you can sit down and you turn on this PlayStation 4 and you get your headset and you talk to your friends and all of a sudden you start playing. You guys don't know this about Jax, but Jackson is a very good gamer. Like, he's very good. There's a particular game called Rocket League where you play soccer while driving a car. It's very strange. But this particular game, like, there have been times he was ranked in the whole nation as one of the better players. But what that means is that for 20 minutes or 30 minutes or an hour, or if it's a Saturday, like lots and lots of time, like what can happen is these six fingers are getting worked out, right? Like he's got barbells. Like he could totally, the practice is happening. They are there, right? He could totally win and like the thumb game with me because he's got all of that. But these two fingers here, they're just hanging along for the ride. They're not doing anything. They're just right there. There's absolutely no purpose. You know, they're just kind of there doing nothing, not practicing anything at all. So what you end up with is three fingers that have muscles on top of their muscles. And then the other two fingers that are just wusses, you know, just wuss fingers. That's what you got right there. So I'm telling you all this to say, when you practice something, it gets stronger, right? When you practice something and use that thing, it gets better. And so in the long run, what you and I have to do is practice living in the light. Now, why in the world would we need to practice doing what's right? Because I'll tell you, culturally, it's not normal to live in the light. Like, it's abnormal. It is weird to live in the light in our world, and here's what I mean by that, okay? We have gotten to a place where nearly everything about our society and everything about the way we communicate with one another lends itself to words like posturing and words like positioning. Here's what posturing and positioning is. Posturing and positioning are where I think about what you want to see about me. And how is that going to help me thrive and me get the things I want and the jobs I want and, you know, and the positions that I desire? What can I do to position myself in such a way that you think that I need to be lifted up or bragged on or whatever? And so we use things like filtration of photos, and we use things like making sure that certain things are out there for the world to see while other things are hidden. Like, nobody has ever gone, you know that selfie I just took? That is the fattest, ugliest picture of me I have ever taken. I cannot wait to post it. Nobody does that, right? We take 97 of them and then pick the best one and then run 3 filters over top of it and then Photoshop it and then post it and say, just rolling out of bed, you know, just chilling. And I know I say that a lot, but it's out there a lot. You know, it's out there a lot. And so what we end up doing is we if we don't watch out, we end up fabricating who we are for the world and trying to come up with something that's better than the real us. And we forget that that's what Jesus is doing. He is coming up with something that's better than the real us. And the way to get there is by being honest about who the real you is. So us fabricating a new us is the exact opposite direction we should be going. Embracing the real you and dealing with the real you is the pathway to the better you. Am I making sense? It's not my pathway. It's not your pathway. It's Jesus' pathway. He tells us to practice the truth. Now, we practice the truth by, and in order to bring honor to God and to recognize His place in the world. There are a few things that will rise up as you practice the truth. One of those is this. You will realize that you are still sinning, but you will be reminded that you were always forgiven. You were still sinning, always forgiven. Now, if you have the right mindset, that will not in some way motivate you to continue sinning. You'll stop seeing forgiveness as permission to sin more or opportunity to sin greater, and you'll start seeing forgiveness as freedom to live in the light. Freedom to live as you were intended. Freedom as you were given, created, beautiful order toward. And so in the long run, here's what happens. Now all of a sudden, when something that's been hidden in my life, designed to never be noticed or seen by you, God forgives that in me. I bring it into the light and I recognize that it's problematic. It's an infestation of bad things. We want it gone. All of a sudden we bring it into the light, and by bringing it into the light, the tendency of it hanging around or sticking around or continuing to be there goes away. I'll tell you exactly kind of how that happens in a little bit. We're going to deal with that in a moment. Let me ask this question. How many of you have ever had a sin? And don't raise your hand. Just think about this internally, okay? Have you ever had something about yourself that you just hated? You didn't like this about yourself at all. It was habitual. It was problematic. It was difficult. And you would go to the Lord and say, Lord, I did it again. I'm sorry. I confess it. I'm going to stop. I confess this, Lord, this is a sin. Please forgive me. Those kinds of things. But in the back of your mind, what you're thinking is, I'm probably going to do that again. And you confess it to the Lord. And you think, I'm probably going to do it again. And you confess to the Lord, think, I'm probably going to do it. And before you know it, it's been weeks or months or years. And there's this constant back and forth between you feeling sorry, telling God about it, and doing it again. Feeling sorry, telling God, doing it again. And over and over and over. Let me explain to you this. The problem is not that you've confessed it to God wrongly. The problem is probably not that you have the wrong motivation. The problem is there's something else that you haven't done that the scripture is going to tell you to do that brings about healing. See, I think you probably don't need forgiveness anymore so much as you need healing from what you're dealing with. And we'll talk about that toward the end of this message. So stay tuned and we'll keep connected. I think one of the biggest reasons why we don't live in the light from time to time is something the Bible calls fear of man. We're genuinely afraid that if people knew the real us, they knew what we had done, knew what we had thought about doing, knew what we had considered doing, that if people knew us, they would not like us. Here's what a great writer named John Bloom on the Desiring God blog wrote about the fear of man. He says, why do we fear others' disapproval so much? We all experience this fear, and most of us don't want to admit how serious its tyranny can be. The Bible calls this the fear of man, and it can weave a web of ambiguity around issues that are biblically clear. The fear of man can immobilize us when we should take action. It can gag us into silence when we should speak. The fear of man feels powerful, but its power is deceptive. That's why the Bible tells us, and he quotes Proverbs 29:5, the fear of man lays a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord is safe. He says the Hebrew word here for snare refers to traps that hunters would use to catch animals and birds. Snares are dangerous. If we get caught, we must do whatever it takes to free ourselves. God has the power to free us, and he wants us living in the safe freedom of trusting him. But he frees us not by removing our fear of disapproval, but by transferring it to the right place. And typically, he frees us by helping us face our false fears so that they lose their power over us. So how do we do that? How do we deal with our fear of man and move into the light in the way that we live? James 5, 13 through 7 or 16 is going to tell us what to do. It says, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Verse 15 and 16 will tell you this. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. And then the last verse is kind of the real big thing for this. It says, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Some of you may have grown up quoting the King James translation of the Bible, which would have said, the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Okay? Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another. Those two things working together. When I confess my sins to another person and that person prays for me and that person confesses their sins to me and I pray for them, all of a sudden we see something that becomes not just a forgiveness work, but we see something that becomes a healing work. And it's really important that we get this differently. We confess our sins to God to be forgiven and cleansed. We confess our sins to one another to be healed. To be healed. Sometimes this works in an extremely practical way, okay? About 15 years ago, some of you have heard this story before, but about 15 years ago, a young man comes to me and confesses to me that he has an addiction or a problem with pornography. He says, you got to help me. I don't know what to do. And so for a few months, he would come and meet with me every 2 weeks or so, and we would talk about it, and basically here's what happened. Every two weeks or so, he'd come talk to me, and he'd go, well, I did it again. And we'd pray together, and he'd come back 2 weeks, I did it again. Okay, well, he came back 2 weeks, I did it again. So I finally said, how are you accessing this? Where's it coming from? And he talked about his computer and how it was in a room with a closed door and nobody knew he was in there. And so we did some work on the internet. I think it was before Google, so it was probably Ask Jeeves or something. We're trying to find a way, you know, through the internet. How can we find this? And we find this website that's called Covenant Eyes. Covenant Eyes comes from an Old Testament verse where the scripture says, I'm going to make a covenant with my eyes not to look lustfully on someone. And this old school, like late 90s, early 2000 technology said this, if you will give us the information on your computer and you will let us connect with it, we will keep track of everything your browser views and we will email that to someone of your choosing. So what happens is we took this young man's computer, we connected it to Covenant Eyes software, which was basically giving spyware freedom to look at your computer. And then every month, his wife and I threatened to send it to his mama, started getting an email every week of everything he had looked at. And it rated them green, yellow, and red. Green being he was on the Sesame Street website. Yellow being he was at ESPN.com and there are some things and you know, certain areas you could find that might be a little bit swimsuity, okay? And then, that's a word. And then red being things that I won't even pronounce or mention in this room, okay? Guess what happened to his temptation? When his wife and his pastor are going to see everything he looks at. He came back in 2 weeks and went, I haven't done it a single time. I'm completely healed. It's amazing. I have no temptation at all. I said, dude, no. I said, the freedom to not get caught was taken away. And when the freedom to not get caught is taken away, that's called moving it from the darkness to the light. And when you take a temptation or a sin and you take the freedom to not get caught out, and you put it right out there in the world where maybe not everybody, but at least the ones you care about most are going to know what you did, okay? All of a sudden, guess what happens to the temptation? It's gone. It's completely gone because the desire to overcome and the desire to please God and the desire to connect with your pastor or your wife or those of you mama, you know, whoever you send it to, like all of a sudden now, I'm not tempted anymore, he says. I'm not tempted anymore. And I said, dude, listen, don't turn covenant eyes off just yet, okay? Let's not celebrate victory and full recovery just yet, but let's just live like this for a few years. Live like this for a few years, and in a few years, guess what God's going to do to your brain? In a few years of not falling prey to the temptation and not falling into the snare of the problem, in a few years, what's going to happen is that your brain is going to be reworked a bit. God's going to renew your mind. All of a sudden, you're going to stop thinking about those particular things in those particular ways, and you're going to start noticing a difference in the way you look at people and think about people. All of a sudden, you're going to have greater sense of what you're supposed to have in your marriage, and you're going to have much less sense of that kind of mindset elsewhere, and it's just going to be helpful because when we confess our sins one to another, we are healed. See what I'm saying? Now, here's the reality. For most people, regardless of what your hidden sin is, most people are going to lock that baby down in a cellar with a safe in it in the bottom of their life and make sure nobody ever sees it because they're afraid of what people will think of them. And those people are probably going to spend the rest of their life going to God every other day or so saying, I did it again. I did it again. I did it again. And my challenge and encouragement to you is this. God does not just want you forgiven. God wants you healed. The forgiveness purpose on this planet is not just to go to heaven, but the forgiveness purpose right here and now is to put you in a place where you can be free from it. Don't live life in a snare thinking that once the snare kills you, at least you're going to heaven. Okay? How about do what the scripture says to not be in the snare anymore so that you have freedom? We confess our sins to the Lord to be forgiven and cleansed. We confess our sins to one another to be healed. To be healed. This leads us to understand how does this happen. You see, I'm fairly convinced, and I've talked about this before too, but we keep coming back to it. It's such an important part of life, is that we need the types of relationships where we can be really, really blatantly honest with one another, and most of us simply don't have that relationship with anybody. 6 years ago, it came up on Time Hop for me this week. It was actually 6 years ago this week, or last week. We made a change in our life that for me was one of the hardest changes that I've ever been a part of having to make. And I left a church where I'd been serving for many years. I had the closest of male friends, people who knew everything there is to know about me, and I knew everything there is to know about them, and moved to a congregation where they didn't know me and I didn't know them. And I realized what it was like to go from having people I could talk to every day about every frustration, struggle, pain, temptation, sin, guilt, whatever. Like I had that, and I was put in a situation where I had to move out of that and not have it anymore. And in the process of not having it anymore, I realized just how hard it is to start that kind of relationship. Like, how in the world do you go, okay, I'm going to pick you to tell the deepest and darkest secrets of my life to, because if you've thought about this, and I'm sure you have, you start thinking, well, I don't know that I would pick you because I don't know that I trust you to not tell anybody about that. Or I don't think I'd pick you because you're kind of judgmental and I'm afraid you're going to be hard on me. And I don't think I'm going to pick you because you're, you know, you might tell me it's no big deal. Don't worry about it. You know, keep going down the road. Like, how do you find the right person to do that? It's kind of like this. It's like going to a garden wanting a tomato, even though you didn't plant tomatoes. But now you're mad that you don't have tomatoes. But like, in order to have a tomato in May or June, you had to plant a tomato in February or March. We can't wait until the May or June of our life to get the thing we're going to need. And so we start spending time with people. We start conversing with people. We start learning about people. We start recognizing things about people that bring about trust in us. And you don't jump straight into, let me tell you the darkest, deepest, most horrible thing about me. Right? Some of you have been on that first date before, where somebody just jumps right into the deepest, darkest, most difficult to deal with thing about themselves, and you get a phone call from a dead aunt who's calling to tell you you have to leave right then. Right? Some of you know what phone call I'm talking about. We didn't have cell phones when I was dating, so I never got to do that, but you know what I'm talking about. So you get out of that. That's not how we jump into those kind of relationships. People who jump into it that quickly, we tend to go, yeah, I'm not going to go that closely with you. But you spend time with one another. You spend weeks, months, and before you know it, you've developed a real friendship. And now all the time, you've realized, man, I've observed things in their life that make me think I can trust them. Like, I hope they've observed things in my life that make me think I can be trusted. And then you take a step. And you say, can we talk about something? I want to share something about myself. And you do, and you see how they respond to it. And guess what? They handled it well. So a week later, you got something else to share. You feel like you can share it. They handle it even better. Before you know it, you've developed, you know, you got a tomato plant going on there. Like, you got something that can give you what you need when, and you can give what they need to them when they need it. See, in our world, we've almost completely done away with friendship. And we've replaced it with social networking. We've replaced it with social stuff. I've told you this before, I know, but I think it's such an important thing that we continue to rethink, okay? In this world of relating to human beings, there's kind of different spaces. There's public space, like where I know that if I'm downtown New York City walking on the street corner, I do not have to acknowledge that you are standing there near me. I don't have to make eye contact. We don't have to shake hands. I don't have to say hi. In fact, if I do say hi, you're going to think I'm weird. Because people don't do that in public space. In social space, that's like I'm at a Cardinals game and the Cubs are winning and the Cardinals hit a grand slam and the game is over and the Cardinals win and I stand around and I high-five the 350-pound bearded man behind me and he picks me up and spins me around like a ballerina and puts me back down and we belly bump and then we sit back down and never speak to each other the rest of our lives. That's social space. It's okay. That's perfectly acceptable behavior in that moment. Now, if he were to lean forward and go, hey, dude, you want to go out for dinner later? I would be like, that's, you're stepping across the line, right? Not until he hits another grand slam and I want to talk to you again, okay? But church is social space. That's why we say words like fine and good all the time. How you doing? Fine. How was your morning? Good. The truth is, you might have had the knockdown, drag-outiest fight of your life with your spouse as you pulled into the parking lot, but when you walk in the door and somebody says, how you doing, you're going to say fine, because it's social space. I wouldn't even call it a lie. I would just say it's not really appropriate conversation for this moment. You know? Here's what we do, though. Here's what we do. We often replace real friendship where you can deal with those kinds of things with one of two or three things. We replace it with social networking so that we're now sharing all the details of our life with hundreds of people who could care less. And people unfollow us over and over and over. And now we're sharing and nobody's hearing and we wonder why nobody's liking or unliking or putting the little emoji with the teardrop when we say something sad. It's because they've all turned you off. Because it's social space, not private relationship. Okay, that's just honest truth, okay? And now we have folks who like are reaching out, and so they put a post on like, I think I'm going to die. And they have 700 friends and nobody responds because they're not hearing it, they don't know. And we're sharing it with a group that doesn't even feel equipped to know how to help us. The other way that we do that is that, and this is what most people do, is we simply don't talk to anybody about anything. We hide it. Maybe we have a therapist. We tell our therapist. That's not a bad thing. If you need, that's, I have had a therapist. I've gone to a therapist. There's nothing wrong with that. But that's not friendship. It's not the same thing. You see, the therapist is not going to end my session and turn right around and tell me all their secrets. You know, the therapist isn't going to open it up and make it an even relationship. They're going to send me a bill. That's what they're going to do. You know, that's not a bad thing. It's just, that's what that is, okay? And if I need that kind of help, I can get that kind of help, but it's not a substitute for friendship. We confess our sins to one another, not just me telling you, but me telling you and you telling me, and us together praying for each other. This is what the American church is missing and has been missing for so many years, because in the 80s, we thought it was a music style we needed to change. And it was the 90s, we thought it was a dress code that we needed to change. And now I don't think we have a clue what it is, but I'll tell you what I believe the scripture would guide us, that our problem is not genre or style. Our problem is authenticity and relationship. We confess our sins to the Lord for forgiveness. We confess our sins to one another for healing. For healing. And when this happens, and I'm done, you guys, when this happens, we end up with the right identity. The biggest problem with not confessing sins to one another is that you live in fear of man or woman. You live wondering and worrying whether or not they would really like you if they really knew you. Galatians 4:6 says, "And because you are sons or daughters, okay, God has sent the Spirit of His own Son into your hearts, crying, 'Abba, Father.' So you are no longer a slave, but a son or a daughter. And if you are a child, a son or a daughter, then you are an heir through God." That is our identity. That is our identity. The enemy wants to keep you ensnared, thinking that you are someone who others don't need to really know, someone who others don't need to really see, someone who others would not really love. But that's because you're thinking about the wrong identity. You might be thinking about the you were before him, but you know him now. And in knowing him, your sins are forgiven. The voids in your life are filled with his Spirit, and he gives you one another for healing. Don't live life without healing when it's right there for you. Simply by developing relationships with people who've also been forgiven by God, who love you and you love them, who trust you and you trust them, and now you've got somebody in your life who cares about you and who knows what to do to help you and can pray for you when you struggle. What we're going to do now is... I'd like to ask Brent just to kind of sing a song for us to think about and listen to. We're going to turn the lights down a bit, and even you can stay seated. You don't have to stand. But let's just think about what it means to live in the light.
I hear the Savior say, "Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin and left a crimson stain. He
Jesus, we trust you, and we're learning to trust you more and more each and every day. Guide and direct us as your people. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Brent. Ushers, you guys can get ready if you'd like. As we get ready to finalize our time of worship together, a couple of things I want to make sure you're aware of. Next week, we will have Seth and Jenna Stennett here to present to you as potential new leaders for our children's ministry. I'm excited about you guys meeting them. Seth will be giving his personal testimony. You'll get to hear his story of faith. He came to faith in his early 20s, and so some interesting things about how God did that in his life. I think you guys are going to really love them. We want to give you the opportunity to meet them and get to know them and develop some affection for them that many of our other leaders have already had the opportunity to develop. But that's coming next week. And so make sure that you're here. It's an important day to be here. We'll also be sharing communion together next week. We'll be taking that together. It's a special time for us as a church, so I encourage you to do that. As you know, we told you a few weeks ago that 2019 started off kind of slow from the generosity giving standpoint, and I think that's probably because we had one Sunday we missed for snow, which takes out, you know, that's quite a bit. And then in addition to that, we had February where the flu and the flooding was everywhere, and so our attendance was down, I'm going to guess, you know, maybe 20 or 30% through the month of February. And that affected, I'm sure, a lot of things. And so some have asked me, Pastor, what do I need to do about online giving? We do have a lot of folks who choose to do it that way. You are absolutely free to do it that way. My family do give online most of the time. And I encourage you to consider that. It's really nice because you can even set up a recurring thing and you don't even have to remember it. If you are like me and you don't know where your checkbook is, like you just don't use it very often, then giving in the conventional at church kind of way might be hard. And so you can do that. Also, for those of you who over the last 2 weeks have really stepped up your generosity, I just want to thank you. We asked a few weeks ago for that, and people have gone so far as to check their own giving records and saying, you know what, I thought I did, but I hadn't. And so they've made sure and tried to catch up or to try to supply or give. And keep in mind, this is a really important thing. We're not looking at this, nor do we ever look at this, from just a dollars and cents thing. This is really about what it means to have a heart of desire to honor and love God, which means that I would rather have a $5 gift from the right mindset and attitude than a $1,000 gift with the wrong attitude and wrong heart. And so don't go into this thinking, well, you know, my gift is not very large. What is that going to matter? It really matters because it's not about dollars and cents. It's about heart, attitude, and worship coming from you. So we're not ultimately seeking money from anybody. We're seeking to lead people to worship the Lord, and we're seeking to see God respond with blessing. That's what we're doing. And so whatever that is from you, I don't know. Whatever that is from you, that's what we're seeking. It's just an honest response from a loving group of people who want to worship the Lord. Okay? So let's pray for this offering and ask that God bless it. Lord, thank you for the generosity of the past few weeks. Lord, I don't know the exact numbers, but I think that you've gotten us really just in the direction of almost back to on track where we need to be. So, Father, I pray that you would help us, even with today and next week, be able to do that and find ourselves leading from a place of confidence and a place of security. Lord, ultimately, we know we can trust you regardless of what numbers say. We know that you are there, that you are leading us, and that we are your church. Father, we respond to you today in worship and in generosity because you have been overwhelmingly generous to us, and we trust you. We want to be like you. We want to live like you, think like you, and act like you. We trust you today, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.